One of the defining images of 2018 has been that of four judges of the Supreme Court choosing to hold a press conference, questioning the manner in which cases were being allotted. At the heart of it represented a serious credibility crisis in the highest court of this country and the possibility of the Supreme Court being split wide open. Is justice then in the dock? To answer that question, Indira Jaising, former Additional Solicitor General, and Pinky Anand, currently Additional Solicitor General. Please give them a very big hand, ladies and gentlemen. Indira Jaising, let's cut the chase. Is the highest court of this country incorruptible, or is corruption a part of our judicial system right up to the Supreme Court? Are our Supreme Court judges, at the risk of contempt of court, purchasable?
Rajdeep, first of all, I'd like to say that I disagree with your definition of corruption, which seems to be limited only to purchase and monetary transactions. Corruption takes many, many, many forms, especially in today's context. And one of them, and one of the most dangerous ones, is succumbing to the wishes of the executive. We live in a country in which we believe that the executive and the judiciary are separated by a wall, and there is no interference by one with the other. So, in my opinion, corruption, yes, monetary transactions are definitely part of the definition of corruption, but it doesn't end there. And if you want to really know whether they're corruptible, I think you need to look behind the curtain and see what exactly is the relationship between the executive and the judiciary and who's dominating whom, who's corrupting whom.
Let me cut the chase again. The fact is that the four judges who held that press conference, unprecedented, were effectively suggesting that the Chief Justice of India was engaged in bench fixing. Does bench fixing take place or not?
Yes, it does, through the power to settle the roster. It's a very beautiful, euphemistic expression, quote unquote, master of the roster. It doesn't belong to a democratic age. And look, it's not this Chief Justice. The fact of the matter is, every Chief Justice has the power to decide which case to allocate to which bench. And by doing so, you can determine the outcome of a case. Let's not get political about it. If you take something like death penalty, there may be judges who are pro-death penalty, judges who are not pro-death penalty, and we lawyers can tell, depending on the judge to which a case is assigned, what the outcome of a case is going to be. So if by bench fixing you mean hand-picking the judges who are going to hear a particular case, the answer is yes.
I'll come to whether that constitutes corruption, but you wanted to respond.
Two things. A, Supreme Court is incorruptible. I think it is high time that we stopped kind of chasing and finding a scandal in everything and saying there is a possibility that the Supreme Court is corrupt. There is a problem because the Supreme Court judges went to press. First of all, it is unprecedented. You're
right. Supreme Court is incorruptible?
It is incorruptible. And we better stand with the institutions and learn to stand with them instead of trying to find something behind the curtains all the time. Secondly, press conference was unprecedented. But right now, whatever it is worth, the work is going on smoothly in the Supreme Court. Thirdly, as far as this roster is called, we lawyers love to have a lot of complexity and technicality in talking about rosters, but when you have a system, somebody has to operate it. There is a captain of a ship. Similarly, there's the master of the ship. Similarly, there's a master of roles, so to say, in the Supreme Court, and somebody has to decide to which court which matters will be assigned. This has been the precedent and this has been going on, and probably this will continue because a decision has to be taken. Simply because some people find it inconvenient, these issues are being raised, but they have gone no further than that. For the time being, for example, Judge Lohia's case is being heard and is being heard by arguments from all sides, and we hope that whatever has to come as the outcome of the case will come forth. Even today, yeah, the arguments are going on. It will carry on Monday. The bench which is hearing the matter is proceeding to hear the matter from all sides. What do we want from the system?
Are you saying, therefore, you mentioned the Judge Lohia case, the case of a special court judge who died of a heart attack officially in December of 2014, questions though are being raised over whether the death was natural or not. Do you believe that given the sensitivity of the matter, that fact that political figures are being drawn into it, Congress is raising questions, there's an SIT demand being made, should such matters be viewed through a political lens or not, Pinky Anand, or should it be purely judicial? You seem to suggest that when things are inconvenient, then aspersions are cast on judges.
Absolutely. What have we come to actually? You have a separation of powers. It is high time that we learn to keep to those lines, and there's a reason. You have the judiciary deciding a matter based upon law, not upon sensitivities of case. So whether a politician is involved, a cricketer is involved, an actress is involved, it doesn't mean that it becomes sensitive. Therefore, it requires a different lens. The case has to be viewed from the perspective of what is presented before the court, and what do you have in this case? You have the family members who do not want to pursue this litigation, who say there's nothing suspicious of foul play. You have district court judges' reports. You have the high court judges' reports. And nonetheless, what is being spoken about today and what is being converted or attempted to be converted is a political platform in a judicial forum. I think we better stop that exercise, because otherwise all the lines will be drawn and we'll be left with no institution with its credibility intact.
Is the judiciary being effectively politicized, Indira Jaising? Is that what, it's not about corruption as much as the judiciary being politically split wide open?
Right. Let me tell you. If at all the judiciary is politicized, it can only happen at the stage of making appointments, okay? It depends on who you're inducting into the judiciary. If at the source, you are going to appoint people who agree with you, or your politics, or your right-wing politics, yes, then the judiciary is politicized. And that is the issue, I think, for me, which is very, very important. Today, we have the collegium which has recommended the appointment of Judge Joseph from Uttaranchal. Why is the government sitting on it? More than 6 months have passed since the recommendation went, and the law of the land is that a person recommended by the Supreme Court, including this Chief Justice, made the recommendation. So it's nothing personal about it. Yet the appointment is not being made. So what is that if not a corruption of the judiciary at the source level?
You're saying the executive wants convenient judges who fit in with a political ideology.
I'm saying...
Are you today saying that that only started in 2014?
No, I that's not my case. I'm not saying it only started in 2014. I have routinely said in an article which I wrote, which you may have read, called Supreme Court is sitting on a volcano, a live volcano. And that's why I disagree with what Pinky said, that all is well. There is an apparent calm in the Supreme Court. There's none. Every time I enter the courtroom, my heart is in my mouth, wondering now, which side of the fence is this judge on? It is a volcano, no less than that. And just
every time you enter the court, the judges are very scared of you.
Oh, well, that's another story.
These judges have been there, Indira, for a long time. So we can't say that at this point of time you're entering, suddenly you have this issue of having sensitivity towards X judge or Y judge. None of the judges before you are appearing are recent appointees in any event.
But Rajdeep, more importantly, let's get back to the issues that you dock. I think the judiciary is in the dock of the Janta Ki Adalat. And I think it's for the people of this country to wake up, take note of the fact, okay, it's not an Indira Jaising or a Pinky Anand whose views are important, or Rajdeep. Four sitting judges of the Supreme Court. These are not NGOs, okay? These are not right-wing or left-wing. These are people appointed through due process of law. They felt compelled. Listen to their words. They said democracy is in danger. Listen to their words. They said, if we don't speak today, we will have to forever hold our peace. Listen to their words. They said, we don't want to be told 20 years down the line that we have sold our souls. But to answer your precise question, is it happening only in 2014? No. It has been happening for a long time. But it's time all of us called a halt to this.
Ma'am, Pinky Anand, you are part of this government's legal team. The fact is, the executive sits on judicial appointments that are inconvenient or cancels them. Gopal Subramaniam, for example, because he appeared in a particular case against a BJP leader, therefore he was denied judgeship. That's the harsh reality. Let's face it. There is something drastically wrong in the executive-judiciary relationship today. And there is a tension which perhaps is not manifest. It's behind the curtain. Behind the gowns that you wear, there is tension. I won't use the word volcano. There is tension. Yes or no?
Rajdeep, when you say there's tension, there's always inevitably, when you have three different limbs of a government, there is bound to be some kind of action, some kind of catalyst, some kind of friction, there's bound to be tension. It depends on what level. But having talked about that, you're talking about X person being appointed as a Supreme Court judge or not. Please understand the way our system works, and we have adopted this system and we're not trying to get out of this system. When the collegium suggests the name of a judge, it is for the executive to respond and to accept or not accept. And till date, please understand, one of the principal issues has been one of security. Are you saying that the government has no right to reject the appointment or the nomination of any judge on the ground of security or national concerns? Or are you saying simply because the name is suggested, it should be accepted without the government having any say in the matter? Well, the law of the land is the government.
So why is the government sitting for 6 months over Justice Joseph's appointment?
Justice Joseph's appointment and two other appointments have been made. The executive is considering the same, and you will have your responses.
Okay, Rajdeep, that's what's known as a pocket veto. You can sit on the case till the day arrives when the judge retires at the age of 62. It's simply not acceptable. Your question has not been answered. Namely, is the executive interfering with the independence of the judiciary?
No, sorry, that was not the question.
No one has answered that. And I don't think it's for me or Pinky to answer this question. The facts are before
I
you.
I don't think the executive is interfering
and
with
it's
the
not for
working
us to
of the
answer
judiciary.
This question. No. It is for you to answer it on the basis of data made available to you. And that's the issue. The issue, Rajdeep, is really democracy. It is transparency. It is the right to freedom of information. And Rajdeep, I would just like to tell you that without a free press and an independent judiciary, we are all lost in this country. Forget it.
The flip side would be that we are also facing what I call judicial overreach. That judges will interfere in every little matter. Look at the mess they've made of Indian cricket. Indian cricket has been, you know, the Lodha panel has moved from one crisis to another. Is the flip side that judges believe that they are truly the Supreme Court, that they will, in a sense, determine what are actions that are clearly out of their realm. So I'm just wondering whether there are two sides to this story. One is of the executive interfering, the other is judiciary asserting its independence in ways that it should not.
On the first front, while you talked about the executive interfering, I think it is a rather crystal clear situation. The executive is not interfering. Today, the appointment of judges is being made by the judges themselves. There is no procedure for removal. Where is the question of the executive interfering? Aside from raising volcanoes all over the courts to say there is this suspicion and there is this foul play that is being talked about, let it come forth a little more and we'll know the real answers even more through the court decisions. Having said that, as far as the other part is concerned of judicial overreach or judicial activism, we are a nation that is believing in a number of social issues, social welfare issues. So there, you have that front in every part of the world, including India. When it is dealing with social welfare issues, you have a judiciary which acts in the interest of the so-called deprived sections or so-called marginalized sections and ensures their benefit. That is one part of it when we talk about social welfare. On the other part, on the policy, you please take the demonetization case. The Supreme Court did not interfere with it. The Supreme Court said it's a matter of fiscal policy. You take the Aadhaar case. The Aadhaar case is currently undergoing consideration. Take a case which came up yesterday. Somebody moved the Supreme Court for saying that population should be controlled and you should have a two-norm family, which was declined by the Supreme Court. You had another one which said exit polls should be banned. Again, that was declined. So you do have a front where the Supreme Court has to consider where to make inroads and where not to make inroads. But very clearly, Rajdeep, this much I will say with you, that matters of policy are something with which the Supreme Court should not and normally does not intervene. However, matters are taken to court. We have become a society where every issue is taken up to the courts for one reason. The rule of law is something people swear by even today. And for that reason, everybody believes that you will have recourse to justice if you go to courts.
It's not just about that. It's also that we are an extremely complex, diverse society. Therefore, issues like right to privacy, which has become, again, critical in a way to the way we will live in the future, or indeed, Indira Jaising, a political issue like the Mandir Masjid issue has now been placed at the doors of the Supreme Court. Just think of those poor judges who are going to have to decide the Mandir Masjid issue. Whatever decision they take, there will be some kind of reaction in society. Are we investing far too much in judges who ultimately are human beings to play the role of God? It's one thing for primetime anchors to play the role of God, but for Supreme Court judges to play the role of God, it's far more sensitive, ma'am.
Well, it does remind me of what, on a lighter note, of what Mr. Harish Salvi said when he entered the courtroom in the Babri Masjid case. He said, I'm representing Ram Lala. So I don't know whether judges are playing God, but lawyers are certainly playing God. But let me come back to your question about judicial overreach. I would say that it's a case also of judicial underreach. And let me give you the example. Demonetization, she talked about it. Why did it fall into a black hole of the Supreme Court? Disappeared with no information when it's going to be heard. Why did it take us so long to get a judgment on privacy after begging and pleading the Supreme Court repeatedly that we wanted placed on board for hearing? It was only Justice Chalameshwar's intervention when he said, I think this matter should be mentioned before the Chief Justice for hearing, that it was listed. And as a pre-retirement judgment, Justice Kehar put it on board, and of course now we have this brilliant judgment, which I have described as the third constitution, the first one being the one which Ambedkar gave us, the second one, Keshavananda Bharati, and I think the third constitution is the privacy judgment. So we also have judicial underreach, and this gets you back to the whole issue of the power to decide which case to hear, when to hear it, how to hear it, and who will hear it, which is euphemistically put under the label of master of the rolls. It's just not on. We are living in the days of transparency, and we want to know on what basis these decisions are.
You know, that's the problem. Kaliko Pool's judgment, a chief minister of a state in his suicide note names various politicians who allegedly were paid off or were pressurizing him at the time, going up to virtually the very highest level. A case diary in an income tax raid names specific initials. Both those cases, the court decides not to hear. If my name was found in an income tax diary, I would have hell to pay possibly before a court. But moment a government functionary or a politician comes, there is a tendency to protect them. I'm just trying to understand, Pinky Anand. People need to know consistency in judgments and transparency. Where is the transparency? Where is the consistency when it comes to judgments involving serious public interest issues?
First of all, Rajdeep, I don't think you have every case that has to be decided on the judicial side. For example, in the Kaliko Pool case, it was decided on the administrative side and decision was taken. Secondly, I need to beg a question. Not only to you, but to anybody, in fact, to say this, are we going to call it a day at some point or not? Or are we only going to keep raising questions? We need to keep our institutions intact. If we keep raising questions and we keep making it, by all means, Janta Ki Adalat is there. Outside the courts, we do raise questions. But as far as we are concerned, we run by systems. We need to keep our systems intact for the need of the integrity of that system, which gives succor to some.
So you're saying the likes of Indira Jaising are guilty of politicizing the court or bringing their personal political ideological agendas into the court, and the court, much like the media, is today split wide open and polarized, right?
Yes, you're right, and I'll go further. If we are going to hear case like Judge Loya, where you have no complainant, no family member, no report against which is there, and that matter is going to be heard day after day, then what Indira says is coming true, that you will not have people who need justice getting justice, because all we are going to do is decide in courts sensitive so-called political or other cases which are coming forth. I think it is high time we went back to a system where we are constructing on a credible surface.
You know, that's part of the problem, is the nature of cases that come and, of course, get the media attention. You know, the Hadia case decided 2 days ago whether a girl from Kerala should have the freedom of choice to marry the man that she wants, or whether there should be an NIA investigation into it. I just wonder whether the courts, by the nature of cases that are coming before it, is willy-nilly being dragged into the political battle, whether it's Judge Loya, whether it's the Hadia case, whether it's the Ram Mandir case. Should the court simply say, look, these are not cases we are going to touch, these are political matters?
I'm afraid that can't be. You can't say the political matters, therefore we will not, or because Hadiyas matter is love jihad, therefore we will not. Courts have to deal with every issue and decide on the sensibility of the issue, but based on law, not based upon questions only being raised somewhere down the line by what we call Janta Ki Adalat. Matters have to be decided on the anvil of the rule of law.
Okay, you're guilty of converting the Supreme Court into a Janta Ki Adalat, Indira Jaising.
Well, I'm now before the Janta Ki Adalat. Let them decide whether... Look, Rajdeep, this polarization in the manner in which we talk to each other, in the manner in which we debate with each other, I'm sorry to have to say, started with some of your television anchors. Now, who they are, I'm not going to name them. But this kind of tutu meme, or you're either for me or against me, it seems to be a global phenomenon now. It's acquired that status. False news has also acquired a certain global status. And I just learned that there's a law in the USA which penalizes false news, a new one on the table. So what is happening is that this kind of polarization which exists in society in some way or the other is affecting all our institutions. So you cannot put the blame for this on lawyers. You can't say, I am going to argue my case in court with all the passion at my command. I don't go to court to argue a case because I'm paid to argue the case. I argue cases that I believe in arguing. And for me, Hadia's case was critical. It was critical to the issue of privacy. You give a judgment of 9 judges saying we are all entitled to privacy. The most private of my decisions is who I choose to marry. No one can question a decision who's the person that I choose to marry. And the Supreme, the High Court of Kerala did that. They not only did it, but they annulled her marriage. Now, which court can we go to? We can only go to the Supreme Court. You come to the Supreme Court and lo and behold, you're told that the NIA, and NIA stands for National Intelligence Agency. They should investigate into why I got married, who did I get married to. And then you have this fancy doctrine of, you know, the argument on the other side was she's been quote-unquote indoctrinated, to which I had to say, well, in that case, all of us are indoctrinated. All of us who have a passionate point of view, all of us who have a politics, we are indoctrinated. You know, you have to respect a woman's decision to marry.
But you won the case. You won the case. So the Supreme Court is not all that bad. You won the case. The Supreme Court gave justice to Hadia. My worry is that when the Supreme Court gives a judgment in your favor, it's all very well. If the Supreme Court doesn't give a judgment in your favor, will Indira Jaising say, oh, there's political pressure on that judge?
No. The process through which you quote-unquote win a case, there's nothing like winning and losing. Every judgment is very, very important. Even the cases we quote-unquote lose do set some precedents. They're very important. I can tell you, Rajdeep, you were there during that pavement dwellers case that we were arguing in Bombay. Ostensibly, we lost it, but it made a huge difference to the debate in the country of the right to housing. But you know, sadly, Rajdeep, I'm taking you back to those days when we were on the pavements of Bombay representing the pavement dwellers. Those were the days when I thought social and economic rights are the most important rights for anyone in the country. Sadly, I've come to the conclusion that without our civil and political rights, our economic and social rights mean nothing. And that's why I want to bring you back. You journalists have a responsibility to safeguard freedom of the press. And I have a responsibility to safeguard freedom of the judiciary.
Okay. That seems like a fair compact. Let me ask you in conclusion, just as a matter of trivia in a way, should we have more female judges?
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, you require female judges in every place and females in every part, including media. I would say that for sure.
Well, Rajdeep, I've gone past the age when I could be appointed as a judge, but I think Pinky should be. And I also think that, but I would also be critical of the government for not appointing more women as solicitors. I'm happy to say that I was the first, and I was very happy when Pinky was appointed as additional solicitor.
Is there one dream case that each of you would like to have fought of the past, which you think that I wish I was there fighting that case. Is there a dream case that you've had, Pinky Anand?
I've had dream cases and dream judgments. I've had the triple talaq case. I've had the demonetization case. I've had part of the Aadhaar case. So I'm afraid there's so much and more. And incidentally, while we are talking today, Indira and I are working together on several matters which require, for example, victim compensation, improving the rights of issues of women is concerned, in the killing in the name of honor, and all these issues we are working together on. So while we speak, while we have differences of opinion in some issues, we do work together in the cause of justice, and may we continue to do so.
Which is great, because as we've been discovering over the last day, that's something very difficult to get our politicians to do, work together. That's something very difficult for our media persons to do, work together. But the fact that two of you can come across and talk to each other rather than at each other, and perhaps find a way to resolve some of the serious crises that are facing our judicial system, and talking about them so openly and freely, is a positive step. Indira Jaising, Pinky Anand, thank you very much. Now I realize why I should have become a lawyer and not a journalist. Thank you.
You're almost there.